Hi, everybody. Welcome to UCSC DNA Day 2021. This is our first virtual DNA Day. We're super excited to be here. We're so thankful to the students from Colleges Against Cancer who are hosting the digital interface for us and making sure that everything goes off without a hitch. We're live on YouTube. I hope that's where you're watching. We're going to start off today with our speaker, Jepoliano Chavez, who was originally scheduled to speak a little bit later, but he's going to kick off the festivities for us, and then we'll be joined by our scientific director, David Hausler. And I'm going to turn it over to Sneha now, who will tell you a little bit more about Colleges Against Cancer.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Zia, for introducing our event. My name is Sneha Jariwala, and I'm the co-lead of Colleges Against Cancer here at UCSC. We helped host this event in conjunction with the Genomics Institute. We usually host a lot of events throughout the year that fundraise for nonprofits related to cancer and cancer research. So to start off the day, as Zia said, our first speaker is Gio Chavez, a postdoctoral scholar from the University of Chicago.
Thank you. Good afternoon, good morning, everybody. I know that there are people in different regions of the world who might be watching this. So I'd just like to say hello. And I want to ask, do they see my screen right now? Okay, great. So good afternoon once again. My name is Jepoliano Chavez. I'm a postdoctoral scholar at the University of Chicago. The title of this talk is Diversity in the Genomics Age, Lessons from SARS-CoV and Neuroblastoma. A little bit more introduction about me. I am originally from Brazil. I came to the US as part of a program called Science Without Borders, which is sponsored by the Ministry of Education of Brazil. And I was a PhD student at the BME department at UCSC under the orientation of Dr. Nader Pormand. Again, today I work as a postdoctoral scholar at the University of Chicago under the supervision of Dr. Mark Applebaum. I'll give you an overview of my talk. I will introduce my objectives in this next slide. And my talk aims to discuss mechanisms driving carcinogenesis and SARS-CoV biology. Basically, I will talk about genetic alterations and epigenetic modifications that drive these two diseases. I will also talk about technologies that are used to sequence DNA and the genetic material involved in these two diseases. And I'll basically talk about the Illumina sequencing. I'll also briefly mention the nanopore direct RNA sequencing in COVID-19 and the nanopore direct RNA sequencing in neuroblastoma, which is a proposed project. And then I will talk about some results that I have in the current research that I am performing. So my objectives in this talk are to highlight the importance of epigenetics and epitranscriptomics in COVID-19 and neuroblastoma. Specifically, I am going to address the genetic and epigenetic alterations in COVID-19 and neuroblastoma. And I'll do that by defining SNPs or somatic mutations to define it in using the genome of SARS-CoV-2. And I will also discuss epigenetic and epitranscriptomic modification using the Illumina and the nanopore technology. A brief definition of diversity that pertains to this talk. The Merriam-Webster definition of diversity is that diversity is a condition of having or being composed of different elements, variety. Another definition is that it is the inclusion of people of different races, cultures in a group or organization. In this talk, I will define diversity as the discussion of the events or the mechanisms that drive the biology of COVID-19 and also of neuroblastoma. And I am basically talking about the genetic variation in the SNPs and the epigenetic modifications. So in this perspective, this diversity of understanding the complexities between and the interplays between genetic variation and epigenetic modification is essential for scientific progress because it allows another layer of understanding about how these complex processes they happen in the body, in the human body. So here I want to start comparing these two processes. So in the left here, we have carcinogenesis being driven by genetic alterations and epigenetic alterations. So on the epigenetic alterations part, we have point mutations, single nucleotide polymorphisms, and also copy number variants. On the epigenetics part, we have some factors such as microRNA, DNA methylation, and also histone modifications. The genetic alterations part is explained on the right part of this figure, where we have the classical definitions on how carcinogenesis happens in the cell, which is by the activation of oncogenes, and therefore the abnormal cellular proliferation, which is characteristic of carcinogenesis, and the silencing of tumor suppressor genes. Once tumor suppressor genes are silenced, genes that also promote cellular tumor cell division and proliferation also take place, therefore causing the cancer disease progression. So this is basically an introduction on how these genetic alterations promote carcinogenesis. Here I want to highlight the role of single nucleotide polymorphisms, which are base pair alterations that are present in more than 1% of individuals. This type of alteration or mutation is thought to be important in the triggering of many types of diseases, not only cancer, and it's not only involved in COVID-19. I will briefly mention one example in Huntington's disease, but alterations in the genetic sequence of genes that are involved in many of these processes may cause alteration in the shape and function of proteins. And this is the basis for the role of many of these mutations in driving carcinogenesis and driving disease progression in many types of diseases. So nucleotide polymorphism or single nucleotide polymorphism is also known as somatic mutations. And this definition is going to depend on the context in which we're talking about these types of mutations. Today, I am basically addressing cancer and COVID-19. And they can be seen a little bit different depending on the context that they are presented. Not necessarily DNA variation represents a threat to the viability of the organism studied. Many times, this alteration is going to allow the organism to adapt, which is the case with COVID-19. I want to now mention epitranscriptomics because I will I'll refer to this later in this topics in this talk. Because epigenetics is increasingly being recognized as an important driver of neuroblastoma biology, as most neuroblastoma tumors do not carry pathogenic somatic mutations. However, approximately 20% of the tumors carry somatic variations, which drive neuroblastoma disease progression. So we need to talk more about genetic variations and how they play or they do not play important roles in carcinogenesis. So again, SNPs or somatic variants affect both monogenic and polygenic diseases. And here I want to illustrate that with the example of Huntington's disease, which was the disease that I studied during my PhD time. Although the genetic nature of Huntington's disease is very well characterized, it's a CAG expansion in chromosome 4. There are other phenotypes that are less well characterized in Huntington's disease. For instance, there is an increased risk for diabetes in Huntington's disease and also other types of dementias, such as Alzheimer's. So this work in Huntington's disease was done in the lab of Dr. Nader Pormand at UCSC. Here I want to illustrate the identification of polymorphisms identified in diabetes genes, but in this case, in Huntington's disease. So what this suggests or shows is that these SNP alterations or these variants are also associated with a monogenic disease such as Huntington's disease. So illustrating the biological role of SNPs, I want to use this example coming from SARS-CoV-2. So this SNP alteration N501Y or asparagine changing to tyrosine is a modification of a nucleotide in the spike protein genomic sequence. This alteration causes increase in polar interaction or hydrogen bonds between the spike protein and the ACE2 human protein. And what happens, as illustrated in this figures A and B here, is that because there is more polar interactions that this newly introduced tyrosine can make with the tyrosine in the ACE2 receptor and possibly with other amino acid residues in the ACE2 protein sequence, this has a serious consequence to the health systems because this new variant is now capable of infecting more patients. It can propagate more quickly among the populations. And so regions that harbor this mutation, they should be really, really, have really, really serious lockdown policies. So this illustrates the use of the genomic science in public policies. So these were alterations in the genomic sequence that affect carcinogenesis and COVID-19 higher infectivity. Now I want to start addressing DNA epigenetic and epitranscriptomic modifications that are also important in these two conditions. So when we talk about epigenetics, I want to introduce here the idea of the epigenetic code, which is the second factor affecting carcinogenesis and COVID-19. So I spoke about the first factor that was the genetic sequence itself and the somatic mutations. Now we have alterations in these three main components of the cellular machinery: modifications in DNA, modifications in RNA, and modification in histone proteins. And the interconnections or the interplay between these modifications form what is called the epigenetic code. And this is thought to play a very important role in carcinogenesis. And as we are going to see here in the biology of SARS-CoV-2. So going a little bit deeper into the notion of epigenetics, I am going to talk about epigenetics as modifications to the chromatin structure that control gene accessibility and expression. So you can see in this figure that we have the cell, and inside the cell we have the nucleus. Inside the nucleus we have the chromatin. And one very interesting notion of the organization of chromatin inside the nucleus is this notion of chromosome territories. So it speaks to the idea that the chromosomes are located in specific places in the nucleus, forming a very well characterized topography, a very well characterized topography of the DNA organization and the genomic sequence. So there is this concept of the topologically associated domains, or TADs, that further explain or illustrate this idea of physical or three-dimensional proximity between the unidimensional DNA. And all this is further added by the notion of chromatin looping, where there is the interaction of the DNA sequence around the histone proteins and modifications in these histone proteins. So modifications in the histone proteins, such as methylation, acetylation, and phosphorylation, affect the accessibility of chromatin, therefore affecting the gene expression as illustrated by the presence of the RNA polymerase. And depending on the epigenetic modification, this is going to cause gene expression activation or repression. And so this is really, really complexly regulated by the topological structure in the nucleus and this three-dimensional organization of this chromatin in the nucleus of the cell. So furthering explaining that, or furthering re-emphasizing this concept, we have the notion of the chromosome conformation capture technologies that take advantage of identifying and sequencing these genomic segments that are in close proximity with these proteins that control gene expression. And I am a biochemist, so I want to establish a parallel idea with this notion of protein three-dimensional structure. And I want to use here the example of enzymes. I was initially trained in the field of enzymology. So in enzymology, we have this notion of a key lock model, where the enzyme binds its substrate and lots of conformational changes in the binding of the enzyme to the substrate end up with the catalytic activity of the enzyme protein in the catalytic site. So similarly, there is also a very complex interplay between the unidimensional genome and also the RNA that is expressed from this unidimensional genome. And this complex organization can inform a lot about disease. So this is illustrated in this figure A with the chromatin fibers, the topologically associated domains, and the chromosome territories, or the chromosome compartments inside the nucleus. In B, I am just illustrating how the unidimensional organization of the genome and its close association or spatial association with proteins in the three-dimensional nucleus. This can be captured, and then we can look at the correlation between the topologically associated domains, the compartments, and the chromosome territories is what this illustrates. So I guess now I spoke a lot about this concept of genome folding and how this can be important and inform complex diseases such as neuroblastoma. And I really do not doubt that many diseases that are caused by virus such as COVID-19 are affected by the mechanisms that I just spoke about. So these intricate mechanisms are thought to be important in driving disease through non-coding variants. So I showed the image of the ACE2 and spike proteins interacting, and that was an example of a coding variant. And it's very clear how the identity of the amino acid affects the function of proteins. But now with everything that I told you, I gave you the notion of how non-coding variants might be involved in this process, because the unidimensional sequence of the genome speaks about the idea that not only the regions of the genome that are coding, they interact with each other. So in a lot of the organization of the genome is explained by the interaction of these regions. And this forms a complex 3D or three-dimensional genomic organization. It therefore represents an interface between the genetic variation and the epigenetic interaction or the chromatin folding. Again, this has very important consequences for complex diseases such as neuroblastoma. And as I said, this brings the idea that viral proteins, for instance, can be having an interplay in this complex process. So this brings us to the definition of neuroblastoma. It's a complex or polygenic disease which originates in the neurocrest tissue, the sympathetic ganglia, and the adrenal medulla. Neuroblastoma accounts for 77% of malignancies diagnosed in children, but 15% of all pediatric oncology deaths. So it causes more deaths than the frequency of malignancy in children. A little bit about the history of neuroblastoma. It's a model cancer for the clinical utility of genomics in characterization of carcinogenesis. The frequently and high level amplification of the VMIC avian myelocytomatosis virus, the neuroblastoma derived homolog, the MYC-N oncogene association with high risk disease has influenced an era of prognostic genomic biomarkers for cancer. Therefore, a multinational effort has resulted in the development of standardized international neuroblastoma risk group, the INRG classification system, that is nowadays used to classify the different risk groups of neuroblastoma. So I want to now talk about a little bit of change in the way of thinking, because you would hopefully agree with me that we would assume that there is an important role for somatic variations in neuroblastoma. However, what the field thinks is that yes, somatic variations are important, but they do not seem to be as important as adult cancers. So what this figure is showing is that in pediatric cancers, we have a lower burden of coding mutations per megabase, lower than in adult cancers. So basically, adult cancers have more somatic variants than pediatric cancer. And this is also true observed in neuroblastoma. So this points to the idea that not only somatic mutations are important in neuroblastoma, but other factors or other mechanisms also explain disease progression. And here I want to bring this notion that other than somatic mutations, epigenetic modifications are important in neuroblastoma. So the heterogeneity of this tumor is as follows. The neuroblastoma tumor mass is composed basically of two cell types. One of the cell types is called the adrenergic cell type, or also the N type. These cells are called adrenergic or N type because they look like neurons. These cells are non-substrate adherent, and they account for majority of or bulk of the tumor. On the other hand, we have the mesenchymal or S-type cells. These cells are considered substrate adherent. This is the reason why they are called S-type. These cells can differentiate into adrenergic cells, and they are resistant to chemotherapy. This is what the cells again look like. The adrenergic type looks more like neurons, like dendrites. You can appreciate the shape of dendrites in the left part of the adrenergic cells, whereas the mesenchymal cells do not have this neuronal-like phenotype. Again, the adrenergic cells are resistant, sensitive to chemotherapy. They grow fast, whereas the mesenchymal cells are resistant to chemotherapy, and therefore they are prevalent in relapse. It is believed that adrenergic and mesenchymal cells can interconvert through expression programs that are downstream of epigenetic regulators. So the cause or the mechanisms of these interconversions involve chromatin accessibility, and later in the next few slides I am going to talk about chromatin accessibility from the perspective of hydroxymethylation in cytosines of DNA. And one idea that we have in the lab is that these phenotypes are also affected by methylation of RNA, something that I'll also briefly mention. So let's look more specifically into the epigenetic technology to access DNA epigenetic modifications that we use in the lab. And the reason why we use this technology is because addition of a hydroxyl group to the methylation DNA precludes gene expression activation. So I don't know if it was completely clear from when I first started talking, but DNA methylation is associated with DNA with gene expression repression. So methylated DNA sequences are less available for gene expression. On the other hand, the addition of a hydroxyl group to this methyl group poises the gene expression for activation. So the chromatin is going to be to become more accessible so that the cell machinery can access the DNA strands and then transcribe the DNA into RNA and later into protein. So this is the reason why we use the 5-HMC technology sequencing in the lab, because 5-HMC accumulates in promoter gene bodies and gene regulatory elements, therefore activating gene expression. So the question that we try to answer in the lab is activation of which genes are important for disease progression. Activation of which genes are important for neuroblastoma progression. This is the question that we are able to answer using this technology, the 5-HMC sequencing. Now, this is a figure illustrating how we apply this technology in the lab. This figure illustrates the process of next generation sequencing library prep, which is basically the preparation of the DNA of interest for sequencing in the sequencing machine. So briefly, we isolate the DNA. We bind adapters that are compatible with the sequencing platform that we use. We label the cytosine in the DNA with a special chemical group. And then through a click reaction, we basically add a biotin group to this hydroxymethyl group, and then we are able to pull down the biotin and consequently the modified DNA. After this, we are able to do some PCR amplification and hybridize these DNA molecules to the platform of interest for sequencing. And this is how we are able to sequence the 5-HMC modifications that we have interest in the lab. So this technology was used by our group to show that there is correlation, or that we can identify genes that cluster high-risk disease patients together. So using, this is a heat map, and the heat map shows the expression of a set of genes on the y-axis. So on the y-axis, we have several different genes that are interrogated here according to their 5-HMC profiles. And on the x-axis, we have the samples. We have the samples corresponding to tumors sequenced from each child. Now, again, what this shows or suggests is that the 5-HMC sequencing can be used to separate children belonging to the high-risk group based on their 5-HMC profiles. Now, the reason why this is very important is because we can basically access or interrogate the 5-HMC profiles of children, of patients from their blood in using liquid biopsies. We can look at many markers that inform about the aggressiveness of the cancer. So basically here we have several molecules that we can interrogate, such as circulating tumor cells, exosomes that are vesicles containing DNA and RNA, cell-free DNA, which is, I think I will speak about these molecules later, cell-free RNA, and also nucleosomes. So what we do is we isolate these markers or these molecules in a liquid biopsy. We sequence these nucleotides. We do whole genome sequencing, whole exome sequencing, qPCR quantification, or epigenetic mark detection, such as the 5-HMC that I mentioned to you. And then we can basically understand whether the tumor of a patient is aggressive or not. And the reason why we want to understand that is because we can predict whether tumor-associated genetic aberration that is removed upon surgery. So therefore, there is a decrease in the load of that genetic aberration. We basically can use liquid biopsy to interrogate the blood of the patient a long time, and therefore understand when is it that the disease starts to come back, so that we can basically think about approaches to kill these cancer cells. I spoke about surgery. Now on chemotherapeutic treatment has a similar idea. So we do the treatment to kill the cancer cells, and then therefore the cancer burden decreases, and we can use the liquid biopsies so that we can interrogate the blood of the patient across time, so that we can follow up, follow exactly when the expression or the detection of a tumor-associated genetic aberration is present in the blood of the patient, so that we can take some action to prevent that from happening. So therefore, these 5-HMC profiling using cell-free DNA has a broad applicability for detection. Okay, this has very important application for diagnosis in progression in adult cancer, and it correlates with active transcriptional networks. I am going to a little bit skip this part, and I am going to talk about the epitranscriptomic modifications that are important for also that we think are important in neuroblastoma. We were talking about DNA modifications. Now let's transition into RNA modifications. So This figure basically gives the idea that RNA modification, here I am talking about N6-methyladenosine addition to RNA, which is addition is writing. This can be removed in several parts of the cell, depending on the gene, how the gene expression is controlled. This has also impact in splicing, determining which RNA variants are going to be maturated or not. And this also influences RNA degradation and RNA, the translation of protein from RNA. So these RNA modifications, again, affect these writing, erasing, and reading processes of RNA biology. I'm going to skip this a little bit because I want to now approach the notion that nanopore can be used to detect these modifications. So a little introduction on...
Hi, Gio. So sorry to cut you off. This research sounds amazing, but we have another speaker that needs to go soon. I think a lot of people had some questions in the YouTube chat, so we listed your email there and they can send those to you directly.
I'm really sorry.
That's okay. Thank you so much for your time. It sounds really cool and it's great to hear how complicated DNA is and how amazing your research is.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation.
Of course, yes. It's great to have you here. So our next speaker is Dr. David Hausler, and he is the scientific director of the UCSC Genome. Welcome, David.
Hi. Hey, Gio. That was just amazing, and the breadth of your research is just stunning.
Thank you, David.
That timing is such that we can't hear all of it, but I am overwhelmed with the number of different topics and all of the different aspects of molecular biology, genetics, diseases that you've gotten into. It's terrific, and I want everybody to know that this technology that Gio was just starting to talk about, the nanopore technology, was invented here at Santa Cruz. And we're very proud that you are an alumnus and that you're taking that technology to the next step. It's really incredible the level at which you're utilizing it.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the invitation.
Just before I begin, are there questions for Gio?
So we do have a couple. I can list those out right now. Okay, so Eduardo asked, do you know any mathematical modeling research that associates modifications in histones, DNA, and RNA?
Yes, the one method that I use right now is called the GSVA method, the gene set variation analysis method. It basically quantifies phenotypes. In my case, I have used this method to quantify phenotypes associated with RNA-seq and also the 5-HMC expression profiles. But there are other methods that can be used as well.
Okay, great. And then our last question is from Reina, and she asked, in driving disease progression of COVID-19, do SNPs occur frequently? And do you know how they are officially accounted for?
Yeah, these mutations are mutations that are widely accepted as mutation that drive the adaptation of the virus to the host. And as it adapts, one of the things that we have observed is that it has increased the capability of the virus to interact more strongly. The virus can interact more strongly with the human proteins, therefore making it become more effective.
Right. Yeah, that's great. Thank you for sharing that. I know some people watching may not be very familiar with science, but due to the pandemic, we always hear in the news, you know, there's a new variant. So I'm thankful that you were able to answer that question. And that's about it from the chat.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, thank you for being here. So David, would you like to get started?
Sure. Yeah. And I just, again, want to say how excited we are. We understand that not everybody has a PhD and can follow everything that Gio was talking about. But I want to encourage everyone to get into molecular biology and understand how important it is for our lives, our genes and how they drive our cells. Are really the essence of life. And we need to understand that despite the very sophisticated details that Gio was talking about, there are some basics that you can know and you can feel that, okay, I understand at least this much about what is happening in life. We all come from organisms that existed long, long time ago. We think the life goes back 4 billion years, very close to the beginning of this planet. And at that point, these molecules of DNA and RNA were linked together to form the essential parts of little cells. So inside these cells, we have DNA and RNA carrying messages as to how to build organisms. Cells learn to divide and they get together in shaping your body. And that body then passes on its cells to the next generation. And this has been literally happening for 4 billion years. So Gio was talking about both RNA and DNA. They're very closely related. We won't go into the chemistry. And in fact, today is DNA day, but I want to actually propose that it's DNA and RNA day. They're both fundamental. For example, the COVID-19 virus happens to be RNA, but that same information can be expressed in DNA. And so for you, the general viewing audience, we don't have to make a huge distinction between these two molecules. They're both really the messages that are driving life on this planet. And actually, speaking of viruses, we think that something like viruses have also been with us for billions of years. So you can think about the life on this planet as a huge collection of cells that have their own messages, and DNA and viruses have been interacting for millennia, for an unbelievable amount of time. And as witnessed in the last year, that has not changed very much. We're still seeing this battle between viruses and DNA, and it's essentially about controlling the life process. So who is the DNA or virus in charge of the cells? And of course, the work that we've seen, which Gio has mentioned, has been very, very fundamental in playing out this virus. And our ability to read the RNA or DNA with a mechanism like the nanopore, as Gio was showing, has been absolutely fundamental. We're very proud, for example, that we have a sequencing center here at Santa Cruz now, which is both a molecular diagnostics lab, which interestingly is looking at the disease neuroblastoma that was also mentioned by Gio. So we're very, very interested in sequencing the DNA from cells that are cancerous. And we're also sequencing the RNA from the virus. So amazingly, the same machine, this amazing little nanopore, can do all of these different tasks in medicine, all the way, as Gio said, from viruses all the way to cells. And also, we got a better understanding of inherited diseases. Sometimes a child may be born with cystic fibrosis, for example, and we can read the DNA and recognize that the child is going to have cystic fibrosis. And we can do that immediately right after they're born and try to take action to make sure that that child has the best life possible. So all of these things, reading the viruses, reading the cancer cells, and reading the DNA that we're born with in all of our cells, are very, very important activities for the future of medicine. At Santa Cruz, we believe that we need to read and share this DNA and RNA information to the maximum and support scientists like Gio who are using it in human health. And that is the basic mission of the UC Santa Cruz Genomics Institute, to work with the rest of the world to gather and share and use this DNA and RNA information for the betterment of science. Now, if we think back a little bit on that, if we think for a while on that mission, we realize that this touches everybody's lives. And this is why we are so keen on looking at the issues that confront us here. For one thing, we found that not everybody was sharing the genome sequences of the virus. And we've had a lot of exciting and very important kind of confrontations now. Angie Hinrichs, for example, in our browser group has written very stern letters, which were published now in Science and in Nature soon. I guess Angie was just interviewed by Nature 3 days ago, about how we have to share that information more if we're going to fight the virus successfully. We've also taken a position on DNA. Of course, we are a product of three things. First, the DNA that we got from our parents. Secondly, the epigenetics that Gio was talking about. So it's not just the DNA, but it's how the genes are expressed that are so important. And thirdly, our culture. And these three things, our DNA, the epigenetics, and our culture and experience, how we grew up, what our values are, that's what makes us ourselves. Santa Cruz is extremely keen now on making sure there is awareness of the whole package at this point. In particular, we've recognized some other problems. For example, genetic medicine is based on a single reference genome currently, but a single reference genome cannot fully express all of the ethnic diversity that exists on this planet at the DNA level, let alone at the cultural level. So the first thing we are working on now is to create a pan-reference genome. We are working with all groups on the planet to have representation of their ethnicity, people from their culture. In the case of tribes, for example, in Australia, we're looking at tribal culture. In case when we talk to Japan, we're looking at the Japanese people as an ethnicity. We want full representation in the DNA that we use for medicine from all the different kinds of people on the planet. And it's a matter of getting involvement. And so I want to encourage you to work with our team to actually engage the peoples of the world in this. In the past, there has been a very negative impact from kind of colonial collection of DNA and analysis. We're even seeing this in a recent article that came out in Science where European scientists did analysis of the DNA from Hawaiian and other Oceania people without their involvement. That makes no sense. We need to engage people in the process of the science itself and in the process of converting that science into medicine that's meaningful for everybody. We need to be open. We need to be engaging in this process. That is a key thing that's happening right now in the Pangenome Project at UC Santa Cruz. So whether it's helping the world share information in a crisis, like the crisis that we're currently in COVID, or to understand better how human diseases are related to our DNA and engage scientists from all over the world in making a medicine that is personal and respects the different ethnicities on the planet. Either way, we have the technology. You saw the nanopore. We have the understanding, and you heard about the depth of the molecular understanding from Gio. We're starting to really understand all of the little pieces of the puzzle, how these molecules work together. What we need now is the will to work together and to make a fair and equitable medicine out of DNA that can help people all over the world. And I might add that this goes far beyond people. So yesterday was Earth Day, and we're not just talking about people, but in fact, we're talking about all of the life on this planet. And the other major issue that we're dealing with is climate change and disruption of ecosystems. We have species that are dying off, going extinct before we can even read their DNA. So that means that millions or even billions of years of evolutionary process are being erased, irrevocably erased from this planet. That is one of the giant failures of our human society that we must remedy right now. It's as if we invaded a planet and started to destroy its ecosystems rather than understand them. That is totally, totally unacceptable. And again, I want to call on everybody, whether you're interested in equity and diversity in medicine, or whether you're interested in preserving the ecosystem, DNA is a fundamental thing. It is the message of life. And we need to read that message, share that message, and do the right thing with that message. So thanks everybody for joining us on DNA today, DNA Day today. And I'm looking forward to the strawberry DNA extraction and all of the exciting events that we have. So thanks so much for inviting me and having such great speakers.
Thank you so much, David, for being here. Like you mentioned, science relies on collaboration and sharing tools that we find. So it's great to see that this is such a priority for you and the Genomics Institute. And we're really thankful to have you here at leading such exciting research. So to everyone watching, we hope you enjoyed our first two speakers, and we have many more where that came from. Right now, we're going to have a short break, so we'll see you soon in about 5 minutes. Hey everyone, welcome back. So our next segment is a series of talks from the Research Mentoring Internship Program Scholars, or RMI Scholars, here at UC Santa Cruz. So let's welcome Shamari Waller.
All right, hello everyone. My name is Shamari. I am a fourth year neuroscience major in the Hauser Salama Lab. And I will be presenting to you my research. Okay, so my research is on the analysis of NOTCH2NL variants and autism cohorts. And like I said, I'm a fourth year neuroscience major in the Hauser Salama Lab at the University of California, Santa Cruz. So a little bit about why we're studying NOTCH2NL, using NOTCH2NL to study autism spectrum disorder, is because NOTCH2NL arose from a partial duplication, which in our common ancestors, the great ape, this copy of NOTCH2NL was non-functional, or what is called a pseudogene. And as we humans evolved through gene conversions events, this NOTCH2NL was duplicated into three functional NOTCH2 paralogs, NOTCH2NL A, B, and C. These NOTCH2NL paralogs are located in the Q21 region, which is a centromeric region on chromosome 1 that is susceptible to what is called distal duplication deletion syndrome. And this produces multiple copy variants of the NOTCH protein. So NOTCH2 uses this pathway where it interacts with a DSL ligand, and upon interaction, two enzymes, ATOM and gamma secretase, can come in and dislodge the NOTCH intracellular domain and the NOTCH extracellular domain. When the NOTCH extracellular domain is released, it will be up. It is taken in by these DSL ligands and uptaken into neighboring cells. And when the NOTCH intracellular domain is released, it will bind with this co-transcriptional complex and regulate genes involved in neurodifferentiation and increase in neuroprogenitor proliferation. So how is this involved with NOTCH2NL? So it's been seen that NOTCH2NL can actually interact with the NOTCH2 receptor and increase progenitor sephirinol and delay neurodifferentiation. And also NOTCH2 can interact with the ligand that is involved with neurodifferentiation and further delay it. So when we see multiple copies of this NOTCH2 gene, we see the rise of neurological disorders such as autism spectrum disorder and phenotypic conditions as macrocephaly. And you can see from the two pictures below, a normal brain from a brain that is induced with macrocephaly. They have different patterns in the sulci and gyrus, and also an increase in gray matter and white matter. And we believe, and it is seen that these different type of connections when this arises can be involved in the rise of this intellectual deficiency. So how do I use NOTCH2NL region for studying autism spectrum disorder? So we kind of go through this methodology where we obtain patient genetic information from lymphoblast cells, and then we extract high molecular DNA from these lymphoblast cells, and then the DNA will undergo a size selection and a cleanup, and then we will enrich it using Cas9, and then our DNA will go through gel so we can understand how large the fragments are, nanopore sequencing, our region of interest to produce long sequence reads of the 1Q21 region that NOTCH lies in, And then we'll be able to analyze these sequences for gene conversions and duplications. And our Cas9 enrichment is not the only enrichment, but we are enriching to see if we can produce these large fragments of our DNA. So some of our aims for our study is to generate these long sequence reads and to see how Cas9 is as a tool for enrichment and producing large fragments, and how different oligonucleotides can target different regions of notch of Q21 or where notch 2NL is located. And does our sequencing results match our knowledge of notch 2NL? So what I'm doing personally is I'm growing lymphoblast cells to 50 to 100 million cells. And they start around 5 to 3 million. Then these cells have known mutations of notch 2NL A and B and some other specified conversions of different sizes that we want to sequence. So that way we can know, are we recovering large regions of the DNA, and does our regions match what we know already about the notch 2NL regions in our cells. So a little bit more about the methodology. We use proteinase K, some digestion buffers, RNAs to get rid of everything that's not our DNA. Then we see how large of a recovery we made and repair any nicks with E. coli DNA ligase, which just repairs any nicks in our DNA. Then we eliminate short reads because we're looking for long reads, and then we dephosphorylate any 5' phosphates from our non-target background so they will not religate. And then we also are building Cas9, so we use different oligos to target our 1Q21 at different regions. And that is our crRNAs. And then we add a tracker RNA and our HiFi Cas9. And then through heat and cooling, these are allowed to form the Cas9 complex. So when we do form this Cas9 complex, we target our notch 2NL at different regions, and we can use Fintum and Chef gels and also RNA application to understand what size of fragments we're recovering and the concentration of in the exact size of our fragments in our Fintum post gels, and RNA application to see how much DNA that we actually recovered from our enrichment. And these are my future steps. I just ran our Chef gel, so I'm getting ready to view and annotate that. And also the Fintum post gel should be done today, so I'll go in lab and analyze that. So hopefully if you guys hear me talk in the future, I have this information for you. And thank you for listening. Oh, and if you have any questions, you can put them in the chat and I can see them. They'll direct them to me.
Yeah, thanks so much, Samari. So one of our questions is from Zia. She said that you mentioned that we can repair nicks in the DNA. So could you elaborate a little more on that process of repair?
Yeah, so I can go back to the slide. So when our DNA is being extracted using our different protocols, it's under high stress and it's very invasive procedure. So it just happens that we might create nicks where they're not, it's not a double strand break. So it's not completely broken. It's just a nick between the backbone of the DNA. So what our DNA ligase does, it's any it goes in and any nicks that we have in the DNA, so like any single strand breaks that we have in the DNA, it just ligates them together using E. coli DNA ligase, it basically goes in and, like, say we have a break like this, just goes in and puts our DNA together, so that way it won't create a double strand break and lead to shearing.
Right. Okay. That's really cool. Thank you so much. And we wish you well on the rest of your research, and thanks for speaking today.
Yeah. Thank you for having me.
Okay. So our next RMI Scholar speaker is Carlos. Carlos, feel free to unmute and share your screen when you're ready.
Yes, sorry. I think I am ready. Hello, everyone. My name is Carlos Arevalo. I am a graduating senior this spring 2021 at UCSC. And through the last year, I have been working, I am an undergrad researcher at the Brooks Lab, where I have been working on developing a pan-cancer analysis, so driving mutations in models, in order to develop a method that can allow us to discover novel driver genes or mutations that might be useful for clinical and research endeavors. So first of all, I would like to acknowledge the Brooks Lab, John and Angela, for the great support and mentorship, and also the NIH and NHRG RMI program, Sia, who is a great director, and the RMI cohort as well, and the UCSC Genomics Santa Cruz for the great opportunity to do research there. As a background, cancer is an evolutionary process, and cancer starts from a single cell that gets a malignant mutation. And this mutation allows the cell to divide rapidly. And because the cell divides rapidly, it allows to create like a ball or constantly dividing cells. And these cells create a tumor, which this tumor might eventually become malignant and then metastasize throughout the body through the lymph or blood system. However, when talking about cancer genomes in general, so we always see these two kinds of mutations that we call passenger mutations and driving mutations, because passenger mutations have been shown to not have a direct contribution to tumorigenesis or metastasis or tumor malignancy in general. So we are only to focus on driving mutations, which are the cancer mutations that actually contribute to tumor metastasis and malignancy, tumorigenesis and tumor malignancy. In order to better understand driving mutations, we first need to have a basic understanding of driver pathways, because that is how eventually driver mutations operate. For an example of a driver, gene or a driver protein might be EGFR, which stands for the epidermal growth factor receptor, which is found in the outer membrane of the cell membrane. And EGFR operates just by receiving an extracellular signal in the form of ligand. And this signal is sent into the nucleus to the RAF and MEK air proteins right into the nucleus. It expresses targets genes involving cell survival, proliferation, or cell cycle progression. However, when EGFR genes gets a mutation, the EGFR dimer with and without a signal, it keeps sending signalings into the nucleus, and it keeps expressing the target genes involving cell survival and proliferation, which eventually allow the cells to become cancerous. So, and when talking about pairs or driver mutations, we found that they have a very strange behavior, so that we call mutual exclusivity, and other that we call co-occurrence. An example of mutual exclusivity is EGFR and RAS, which this is an example in bladder cancer. For example, the yellow and green bar just illustrates the tumor stage of bladder cancer, and the other bars just illustrate them where in that specific stage the mutation appears. Each mutation appear. For example, in RAS mutant, which is a somatic mutation, has been shown to appear in invasive and non-invasive bladder cancer. However, because RAS somatic mutations is mutually exclusive with EGFR, they have never been found to be co-occurrent, which means they have never been found to be mutated at the same time or the same tumor stage or the same cancer cell line, which means that they are mutually exclusive. On the other hand, co-occurrence just means that two different driver mutations, just TP53 and EGFR, they are found constantly throughout tumor stages or tumor development or metastasis or cancer cell line, have been found to be mutated at the same time. So we know that we have these events that we call driver associations or driver modules and driver mutations, but we don't fundamentally know how we can use like the big picture of these association or these events in order to develop a better early detection advances and treatment for these malignancies. And in order to understand how these driver modules or driver alterations operate, we first need to develop a comprehensive driver mutation landscape in tumor samples and cancer cell lines in order to see how they actually work in the big picture. So, and in order to potentially discover a novel driver gene that might be contributing to tumor malignancy or tumorigenesis, we develop a cancer discovery approach. So this is the first part of the workflow. So, and this cancer discovery approach just includes using whole exon somatic mutations or whole exon sequencing data from the TCGA Pan Cancer Atlas. We just include 33 cancer types and over 10,000 samples. And the CCLE or the Cancer Cell Line Encyclopedia, which include 44 unique cancer types and over 1,000 different cell lines. Then we just process all this data into a uniform analysis, which apply the same metric to both compendium, the TCGA and CCLE. And we end up with a landscape of over 3 million somatic single nucleotide variants. Then we input this data into a different pipelines, one which is OncoDry FML, which is a pipeline to call and identify novel driver genes and driver mutations. And then we validate those results from OncoDry FML using driver power. And then we further analyze the significant driver genes and mutations. And this is how the landscape of TCGA and CCLE looks like. CCLE includes 43 cancer types, 44 if we take colorectal adenocarcinoma and rectal adenocarcinoma as two separate cancers. And the TCGA, which includes 32. And between both compendiums, we have 27 mutual cancer types, which means 27 cancer types that I share between both collections. So, and this is how the mutational landscape for 49 unique cancer types in both TCGA and CCLE looks like. So 64% of the mutations are missense mutations, 28.6% are silent mutations, and the rest are divided between friendship, friend insertion, and infrain, and non-stop and nonsense different mutations. So our cancer driver discovery just uses what is called a functional impact score, which just use the score or the deleteriousness of a single nucleotide in the reference genome. And depending how many mutations are found across different tumor samples are found for a specific genomic region or gene, this depending on the number of mutations, for example, if the mutation is higher, it has a higher recurrence, so it's going to have a higher functional score compared to other mutation that is only found once in the same genomic element. So in doing so, we were able to run OncoDry FML and identify potential driver genes in TCGA and CCLE. For example, the genes are found in the middle of the two cutoff, which a Q value of 0.1 just means that those genes were found in both TCGA and CCLE. And the genes just in the bottom of the cutoff closest to the X axis, just means that they were found only in TCGA only. And that means that I went found closest to the Y axis. Those are the genes that were found only in CCLE only. So in doing so, we were able to identify this group of super drivers, which are driver genes that are very common across cancer types. So for example, TP53 was the most mutated driver to be found in both compendiums in the TCGA and CCLE, and the one to be the most significant at the same time. And then we have other super drivers like KRAS, P10, RB1, CDKN2, and RAS, CASP8, and STK11. All of that group are very common in across different cancer types. And just the color, the yellow and blue color just means that if the gene was previously annotated using the cancer gene census, which is the cosmic cancer gene census, which is just a catalog of the non-driver gene to be actually curated. And the And the blue color just indicates that the gene has not been previously shown to be a driver previously. So, and we found these very interesting genes, that one that is called DSPP and the other is called PTPRQ. And DSPP has been previously shown using experimental approaches to has been suggested to be the potential driver, but has never been previously shown in genomic analysis to be a driver gene. So, and this is very interesting because we were able to actually see to be a highly mutated and at the same time, a very significant driver, a potentially driver gene. And then combining both the TCA and CCLE, so we were able to call all potential driver genes in the compendiums. And we compared the observed p-values versus the expected p-value. And we identify the group of potentially driver genes to be most significant in the pan-cancer analysis, which is ELABL1 and DNAH9, FLH2, et cetera. However, among this group, we also identify very common potential driver genes such as TP53, KRAS, CDKN2, et cetera. And then we compare the mutation count versus the observed p-values of every single gene. And as well, and also we found that TP53 is the most mutated driver across all cancer types and one to be one of the most significant at the same time. However, we also found this landscape of non-annotated driver genes that further need validations. And this plot just is a bar plot, just indicating that the percentage of driver genes to be annotated and non-annotated, which this just means that over the 50% of drivers that we were able to identify using the pipeline are non-annotated in which further need validation. And only a small percentage of those genes are annotated in the CGC status. And as a conclusion, DIAs indicate how helpful are the cancer cell lines genomic data in order to identify potential novel driver genes and associations, and also provide us comprehensive landscape of driver genes in cancer. And our future work just includes validating these potentially driver genes or analysis just using the orthogonal methods, such as driver power, which is another pipeline in order to the cause potentially driver genes in coding and non-coding genomic regions. And future work to that might include just developing methods to better understand driver models and how this combination of these leads to different cancer outcomes and malignancy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Carlos. So we have one question for you. So it looks like you're a biologist, but you don't actually work with human cells. So how did you get involved in computational biology research?
Yes, I have been very interested about the big questions in cancer. So, and coming to UC Santa Cruz, I think if you are really interested in trying to solve or trying to understand some of the big questions in genomics and cancer and diseases. So it's very hard not to get involved into computational biology or bioinformatics, because I think it's easier in order to understand or in order to do a big scale analysis.
Yeah, I agree. That sounds great. We actually just got another question. So what kind of bioinformatic programs do you use to sort through all these different types of genes that could potentially be drivers of cancer? So what bioinformatic programs?
So I didn't use any specifically program. I just used the pipeline, and then I did all the processing just using R and Python mainly. Okay. I didn't use any software specifically, yeah.
Okay, yeah, but mostly, you know, R and Python to analyze.
Yes, yes.
Right, okay, cool. So that's all our questions for today. Thank you so much for sharing, and we wish you well on your future research.
Thank you.
Okay, so our next presentation is from the RMI scholar, Serafina.
All right, hello. My name is Serafina Nieves, and I am a fourth year in biomolecular engineering and bioinformatics at UCSC. I'm going to be presenting an overview of a research project I've undertaken in the Corbett Dedig Lab, which is focused on evolutionary genomics. My project in particular focuses on horizontal gene transfer events from Wolbachia to arthropods. I'd like to start off with what is Wolbachia and why am I studying it? So Wolbachia is a genus of bacteria that frequently infects arthropods and lives within their cells. Studies have estimated that anywhere from 20 to 66% of terrestrial arthropod species harbor Wolbachia infections. This is due in part to the profound effect that Wolbachia can have on arthropod biology. The Wolbachia bacterium has a variety of interesting mechanisms to ensure that it is transmitted within and between generations of arthropods. These mechanisms include the ones we see here on the bottom left. For instance, in feminization, Wolbachia can make genetic males express female traits. In parthenogenesis, it can make infected females like self-mate and produce offspring. In male killing, it actually reduces the viability of male embryos so that the females carrying the Wolbachia infection will be sure to pass them on. And in cytoplasmic incompatibility, only mating pairs with an infected female will produce viable embryos, ensuring that Wolbachia is successfully passed through the maternal lineage. So these characteristics are really important, and Wolbachia is important as a whole because it is being considered as a biological control mechanism for various disease vectors, such as mosquitoes. Using some of these characteristics of Wolbachia, we can actually change the disease ecology landscape of malaria. For instance, because Wolbachia is so successful at driving throughout a population, if we inserted a transgene that conferred malaria resistance into Wolbachia, we could actually replace the wild type mosquito population with one that is resistant to malaria that reduces and would reduce disease transmission. In another case, using these mechanisms that reduce the number of viable offspring, we can actually cause a population crash, reducing the number of mosquitoes in the wild and thus reducing malaria transmission in certain communities. So because Wolbachia lives within arthropod cells and has such profound effects on its host, it's pertinent to ask what interactions are there at a deeper level. For instance, my project is looking at what interactions happen between arthropods and Wolbachia at the genome level. And previous studies have suggested that genes actually jump from Wolbachia into arthropod genomes. So I'm interested in how we can find these horizontal gene transfer events. I do this completely computationally, so I would like to use publicly available sequencing data to find when these transfers occur. I'd like to know how often this occurs and what happens to these genes after they transfer into the host and they're in a new environment. So the first question is how to find these genes in computational data sets. And because these data sets are entirely computational, it's actually not a trivial question. I have to find out how to distinguish between genes that are actually present in a arthropod genome just from the sequencing data, as opposed to a gene that was sequenced from a whole Wolbachia bacterium that just happened to be in the arthropod cell at the time of sequencing. One of the ways I've done this is I've mapped the DNA sequencing data to the arthropod host reference genome. I then looked at the read sequencing depth between genes I believe were transferred from Wolbachia and genes that I knew to be from arthropods. I would expect if this gene was actually inserted into the genome that it would have the same or on average read depth at these sites. If it wasn't inserted into the genome and it was instead accidentally sequenced from a whole Wolbachia bacterium, the read depth here might be 800 times, whereas the read depth of the rest of the arthropod genome might be 40 times. The second thing I looked for was I looked at the sequencing contigs, which are just chunks of DNA that were sequenced and assembled together. I'd like to see, ideally, that the gene I believe was transferred from Wolbachia was sequenced in line with two genes of arthropod origin on either side. Another thing I looked at was the expression data for Wolbachia transferred genes and host genes. I was just looking out of curiosity to see if these genes were being utilized in their new locations in the arthropod host. And I found on average that the genes are expressed at lower levels. The Wolbachia transfer genes are expressed at lower levels than the host's own genes. And fourth, I looked for introns present within the Wolbachia transfer genes. Introns are a primarily eukaryotic feature, so we would expect to see them for genes that had been within a eukaryote, such as an arthropod, for some time. The next thing I did after finding genes that I thought were horizontal gene transfers from Wolbachia to arthropod was ask, what are they doing now that they're in an arthropod? Are they behaving differently from an evolutionary standpoint in arthropods than they were in their Wolbachia that they originated from? One of the ways to look at this question is asking how these genes are being selected for in their new locations. And basically what that means is this gene being utilized heavily? Is it adapting and providing some new function that the arthropod host didn't previously have? Is it being used and conserved so that it isn't broken? Or is it not really doing anything and just acquiring mutations haphazardly? A way to measure this is by using a DNDS ratio, or the omega measure. And it's basically a ratio of mutations that change the encoded protein versus mutations that don't. If we have a very high number of mutations that change the encoded protein, as opposed to mutations that don't, we would expect that this protein is adapting to its new environment and actually providing some important function. If the number of mutations that change the encoded protein are very low compared to mutations that don't, we'd expect that this gene is being preserved and conserving some function that shouldn't be broken. So as you can see in this plot, I've plotted the omega for genes as they are in their Wolbachia that they originated from versus these same genes, but now in the arthropod that they transferred to. And you can see that along the XY line, most of the genes fall along the XY line, indicating that they behave pretty much evolutionarily the same between the Wolbachia that they started from and the arthropod they transferred into. However, we can see some significant differences in some genes indicated in red. And we actually see a trend where these genes always seem to be accumulating mutations and moving upwards. This can indicate either that the genes are acquiring adaptive mutations and providing some new function to the host and are on their way to becoming important genes for the host, or more likely, these genes are being transferred into arthropods. They're sitting in the arthropod genome and acquiring mutations very quickly and degrading until they're actually no longer able to be detected. So given this, the next parts of my research, I'd like to look at how often these genes are transferred into the arthropod genome and how long it takes for them to be degraded. Another thing I wanted to look at is what types of genes are being transferred. Is there some bias towards genes of certain functions that are transferring into arthropods that might indicate they provide important functions? I'd like to thank Dr. Russell Corbett Dedig for his guidance and advising on this project. I also want to thank the research mentoring internship program, Dr. Zia Isola, and Dr. Angela Brooks for the support and resources that they provide that made it possible to undertake this project.
Thank you so much, Serafina. That was some really cool research. It looks like we don't have any questions for you right now from the chat, but thank you so much for being here, and we wish you luck in your future research.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Okay, so right now we'll be taking a short 10-minute break. During this time, we may play a few videos about the Genomics Institute, but feel free to take a break and we'll get back started on the RMI Scholars after the break.
Genetic code determines how you live. Here we go, genetic code determines how you live. All size, shape, color.
Welcome back, everyone. So we have two more RMI scholars that will share their research. Let's get started with Gifty.
Hi, everyone. My name is Gifty. I'm an undergraduate researcher, and I will share my screen. Can you guys hear me? Can you see the screen? Okay, good. So I was saying I'm an undergraduate researcher in Professor Hussler and Salama's lab, and I work closely with my mentor, Gary. And my research is in understanding NASH2 and NLRP genes and their effects on NASH signaling. And so we're interested in the NASH2 and NLRP gene because it's located within this 1Q21 distal deletion duplication syndrome. So it's located within chromosome 1 in the Q arm. And NASH2 and NLA and NASH2 and NLB serve as a breakpoint for this syndrome. And so copy number variation within this region is associated with having neurodevelopmental disorders such as microcephalia and microcephalia and autism and schizophrenia if there is deletion or duplication in this region. And one of our working hypotheses is NASH2 and NLRP contributing factor for these phenotypes. So with that, we're interested in understanding how NASH2 and NLRP affects this NASH signaling pathway, which I'll get into in a little bit. But so we're interested in NASH signaling because it's important for proper brain development and determining the timing and the duration of neuroprogenitors proliferation and also differentiation. And so NASH signaling is a cell-to-cell communication in which they communicate through a ligand and the extracellular domain. So NASH is a transmembrane protein with an extracellular domain and an intracellular domain. So when the extracellular domain binds to a ligand, there is a series of cleavages that follows, sending the intracellular domain into the nucleus and altering gene expression. And so we all have different variants of NASH2 and NLRP that get exerted into out, and they could interact with this NASH receptor, and they have an ability to enhance this NASH signaling pathway. And so we're interested in finding out how the different NASH2 and NLRP variants that exist in the population and how they have a different ability to enhance this NASH signaling. And so in order to understand how the different NASH2 and NLRP proteins enhance this NASH signaling pathway, we'll be using a NASH reporter assay. So a cleavage will result in an emission of light instead. So, and we'll measure that light using a luminometer. And so in order to make the different NASH2 and NLRP variants that are known to exist, we're using a site-directed mutagenesis technique in which we are introducing a mutation through the use of a primer. And so this primer sits on the plasmid and it elongates further, resulting in this double-stranded DNA in which it contains the mutant. And so within the PCR step, there are several steps in which it gets phosphorylated and ligated. And then we treat it with DPNL to get rid of our template DNA. So only the plasmids that contain our mutation are left. And then we transfer those into a bacteria cells through the use of heat tracking techniques. So cells that only contain our plasmid that have a kanamycin gene could grow in this kanamycin resistant plate. And so we pick several colonies to even amplify further. And then in order to extract the DNA, we do centrifuge and lyse. And we do several washes to get, after binding the DNA to a column, we do several washes to get rid of other stuff in the cell. And so we elute the DNA using a proper buffer such as TE. And then in order to verify whether the mutation or the mutation that we want to see happens, we do Sanger sequencing to verify the mutation. And this is one of the successes that I had in the lab generating a mutation. And so we're looking at the Sanger sequencing result in which the arrow show us the mutation that has occurred. And so on the bottom, we're looking at the amino acid sequence, which is going from an I to a T. And then on the top, we're looking at the nucleotide sequence in which as changing from a T to a C. And so binding step would be generating the different Nashtoina variants that are known, and also in doing the Nash Reporter essay that I was talking about, in which I'll be reading the different emitted lights using the illuminometer. And with that, I would like to thank you guys for listening and also for having me here. And I would also like to thank my mentors and my PIs for giving me this opportunity. And if you guys have questions, you guys could put it in the chat and they'll direct it to me. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That sounded like some really great research, and it's really impressive. I don't think we have any questions yet, but if there were to be questions, feel free to, you know, jump into the YouTube chat and answer them after. And we wish you well on the rest of your research. Thank you for speaking.
Thank you.
So our next are my speaker. I believe we're actually going to transition to a 5-minute break now. And after that, please stay tuned because Elizabeth Padilla from the University of Puerto Rico, Aguadilla, will be speaking about her research. So see you in 5 minutes.
Hi, my name is Lynn.
Hey everyone, our final RMI scholar presenting today is Lynn.
Yes. Hi everyone, my name is Lynn. I'm from the Hartzell Lab at UC Santa Cruz. My project is to characterize a genetic suppressor of a histone H3 mutation that perturbs transcription elongation in budding yeast. I'd like to first acknowledge my PI, Grant Hartzog, my bench mentor, Michael Duty, my RMI mentor, Zia Isola, the UCSC Genomic Institute, and the NHGRI for supporting this project and my training. So all eukaryotic cells contain chromatin, which allows compaction of DNA into the nucleus and regulation of gene expression. And this chromatin structure breaks down into basic subunits called nucleosomes. We find that structural changes to this structure often have large effects. The top right figure here is another illustration of the wild type chromatin as you see on your left. The black dashed line marks the middle point of each nucleosomes in wild type chromatin. The what gray region illustrate an example of cryptic promoter, which is an inactive promoter. Nucleosomes binding to DNA prevent aberrant transcriptions that can occur at these cryptic promoter sites within genes. We identify a mutation on histone H3 encoding gene 88T2, which we called 15R. This lower figure illustrate the chromatin structure in the 15R mutant. Mutated histone is labeled in solid red. This mutant is temperature sensitive, has cryptic transcription, and genome-wide shift of nucleosomes from their original position. One phenotype that we're interested in and followed is the temperature sensitivity of this 15R mutant. The bottom panel recorded viability of cells at selected temperatures. 15 and 30 C's are permissive for 15R mutant, 39 is non-permissive. So in wild type cells, you see that they're viable, they're alive at all three temperatures. 15R mutant is alive at 15 Celsius, health, sick at 30 Celsius, but is entirely dead at 39. Subsequently, we isolated a suppressor of this 15R mutant and arbitrarily called the suppressor sub-G. 15R sub-G double mutant has phenotypes similar to that of wild type cells. My project is to find out where this mutation, which we called sub-G, is, which known gene is its mutation actually falls onto. So we sent this double mutant out to whole genome sequencing to sequence its entire genome and find any mutations that are present in its genome. Whole genome sequencing suggested that sub-G is either IPP1 or PEP12. IPP1 encoded for inorganic pyrophosphatates, an enzyme that catalyzes breakdown of pyrophosphate into two inorganic phosphate groups. PEP12 gene encodes for a T-snare protein that involves in recognition and fusion of vesicle that transport, vesicle transport from Golgi to vacuole to degrade transported materials. We performed linkage analysis to find the linkage between either sub-G and IPP1 or sub-G and PEP12. The results show that sub-G falls neither onto IPP1 or PEP12. So where does that leave us? We can go back to the original 15R sub-G double mutant and gives this double mutant random fragments of yeast genome to find fragment that can complement this sub-G recessive mutation and sequence that fragment to find the gene it carries. So why is this sub-G identity so interesting? There are so many proteins responsible to maintain the chromatin structure, which is incredibly dynamic. whatever gene that subg falls onto. This gene product is interacting with the chromatin to restore the temperature sensitivity of 15R mutant. It could be that this gene's product is a protein which had not been addressed to be interacting with the chromatin structure in literature before. And here are my references. And here I can take any questions.
Hey Lynn, so that was a really great presentation. Super impressive research. I don't think we have any questions in the YouTube chat, but feel free to monitor that in the next couple minutes, just in case someone has a last minute question. But thank you so much for presenting and good luck on the rest of your research.
Awesome, thank you so much.
Bye. Okay, so it is with great pleasure for me to introduce our next speaker, Elizabeth Padilla from the University of Puerto Rico, Aguadilla.
Thank you. I'm gonna share my screen. So you should see it now. I'm very excited to be part of the DNA Day today. I'm very honored for the invitation. And I want to share a little bit with you guys today my passion, which is microbiology, and how I use molecular biology tools to study them in the environment. I'm gonna do this talk, part of it in English, and another part in Spanish. I have slides in both languages, and maybe at some point I will use an in-between. So this is an experiment, but I thought it was a great idea to be inclusive and also express my science and my interest in both languages. A little bit about me, like the moderator said, I'm from Puerto Rico. I'm currently a professor here, born and raised. And then once I got my bachelor degree, I went off to live in Georgia for my master, in Tennessee for my PhD. I lived in DC for 1 year, and then I came back to Puerto Rico where I am a professor. Now I came back almost 5 years ago to the island. My degrees have been interdisciplinary. I have degrees in biology, biotechnology, microbiology, but I'm mostly, I consider myself a microbiologist. And thanks to experiences that I had early on when I was an undergraduate, like you guys, I think that created something in me and paved the way to where I am today. So cuando fui estudiante subgraduada en la universidad, tuve una experiencia muy temprano de hacer investigación y trabajar en el laboratorio, y eso me ayudó mucho a desarrollarme a donde estoy ahora. A big part of that was my participation in summer internships, in internados, investigación. And that certainly awoke the researcher in me. And I knew back then that I wanted to do science and research for a career. And I would probably say that I'm a first generation student for the product of the public system. So all of you students that are out there that share similar backgrounds know that there are no barriers and that everything is possible. Yo soy de aquí de Puerto Rico, primera generación para ir a la universidad y siempre fui a la escuela pública. Mi participación de internados y de experiencias de investigación me llevaron a donde estoy ahora mismo, y quiero que sepan los estudiantes que todo es posible y que no hay barreras para ustedes llegar a donde quieran. So why microbiology and why am I so interested about it? Well, I think it's the diversity that encompasses is magnificent. And you know, it's very interesting lifestyles that we get to study. It's a whole universe of life at the micro scale that we cannot see with our bare eyes. So la microbiología es un mundo muy fascinante, de verdad, que nos deja nosotros estudiar un mundo que es invisible a los ojos. Microbes are a big part of our planet and our lives, and sometimes we don't think about it that way. There are more species of bacteria than any other life form, and you can see it here in the numbers. They account for over 3/4 of our species on Earth. Los microorganismos son la muy grande mayoría de todas las especies que existen en la Tierra, como pueden ver aquí. Por lo tanto, 78% de las especies que existen son de microorganismos. And they account for a big portion of the biomass that eats in our planet. Sometimes we think about plants and animals and humans are ruling the world, and basically no microbes rule the world. And you can see on the numbers here, and also in our daily life, with food that we eat are all products of microbial activity. Los microorganismos son los que rigen todos los procesos de la tierra y están en muy abundancia en toda nuestra tierra. De hecho, son la mayoría de lo que habita en esta tierra y son parte también de los alimentos que nosotros tomamos. We biologists like to classify things. So in the tree of life that we have gathered with information, thankfully, genetic information that we have gathered from all organisms, we classify them in three big groups, three big domains that we call one bacteria, another archaea, and eukarya. Thanks again to the hard work of molecular biologists with microbiologists to make this kind of molecular clocks where we can see how things differ, how they are look alike together, and how they have a common ancestor back when life started. So going on the same line, what you see here is again the tree of life on its side. You are here, part of the eukarya domain, but all of these two domains are completely unicellular and are completely microscopic. And also a big part of the eukarya domain is microscopic, things like yeast, protozoa, and so on. So you think about it, and yeah, all the pale yellow is 2.5-3 domains of life live and thrive at the micron scale. So I like to think that if you are microbiologist, somehow you are also an expert of life because it is really the more abundant form of life on Earth. We mostly know about bacteria because they're very diverse because they're also associated with disease. But this domain archaea that is unicellular, microscopic, is also very interesting and they thrive in extreme environments. Este es el árbol de la vida y dos de los tres grandes grupos se viven todo a escala micro, son microorganismos unicelulares. Sin embargo, entre los eucariotas, donde están las plantas, los animales, los seres humanos, también un grupo bien grande se vive a escala microscópica. So I'm an environmental microbiologist, but I use molecular biology tools every day. I like to be able to go to the field and study these bacteria in the environment and in their natural habitats. And there's two lines of research that I've been able to pursue. One of them is how they live in extreme environments and how they can be applied to clean contaminated sites with a technique called bioremediation. And I will talk about this a little bit more in the next slide. Yo soy una microbióloga ambiental, pero me gusta trabajar con ellos en el laboratorio, pero también en el campo. Y sobre todo en dos grupos de líneas de investigación que son de ambientes extremos y las técnicas de bioremediación que son para nosotros poder limpiar lugares que han sido contaminados. Here you can read maybe faster than me speaking the definition of bioremediation, which is the use of microorganisms to clean and restore contaminated sites because bacteria use these toxic compounds as their food source for energy, carbon source, etc. So when there's a problem like an oil spill, and that happens in our first world problems, we have a solution. And you can see on this cartoon where that a microorganism has a close encounter with an oil, a hydrocarbon. This can be jet fuel, diesel, gasoline. And then it uses this as a source of energy. In this case, converts it to CO2 and water. And then that's the product of that metabolic reaction. And we can restore the levels of safety in this site because the hydrocarbon levels, the toxic chemicals go down. Cuando hay un desperdicio así de petróleo, tenemos los microorganismos que nos ayudan a degradar esos contaminantes, en este caso los aceites. Ellos lo degradan a CO2 y agua, y de esta manera nosotros podemos limpiar sitios que han estado contaminados. there are various techniques in the field of bioremediation. And I won't go into detail, but so that you can understand how I use the molecular biology tools, I will explain two of them that are called biostimulation and bioaugmentation. When we do biostimulation, that means that there's a spill and the contaminant is at the site. And there's also bacteria there that can degrade that toxic compound or transform into a benign form of the compound. And I think about it as they are my soldiers. They are out there in the field and fighting for me to help this contaminated site, to help restore this contaminated site. So what I do is the bacteria is there, we can promote their natural growth by adding nutrients or enhancers to this site. That can be maybe putting vitamins into the site, pumping air if they are aerobic and need oxygen to reproduce, or maybe adjusting the pH at the site. So you can add those enhancers so that they multiply, eventually transform that toxic compounds to something that is no longer harmful. That is what we do in biostimulation. When we do bioaugmentation, it's because we have a different scenario. The spill is there, but my soldiers are not. I don't have the bacteria that can degrade the compound. En la diapositiva anterior, estaban las bacterias en el lugar que me pueden ayudar a degradar el contaminante. Sin embargo, en este escenario, no se encuentran las bacterias que me pueden ayudar. So what we do is we can actually grow them in the lab. We have the cultures available because we have studied them before that can do the transformations for you. So we can go at the site, inoculate it, just as we do maybe a Petri dish or a tube, and put my soldiers there and everything that they need to be happy, or the nutrients, media, whatever is needed so that they can then reproduce and transform the contaminant. Y en este caso, pues, yo puedo llevarlos del laboratorio al lugar para que ellos puedan entonces hacer las transformaciones por mí y limpiar el lugar que está contaminado. So how do we decide if I'm gonna do one treatment, bioremediation or biostimulation? So I need to know if my soldiers are there. And for that, I need biomarkers. So I like to compare a contaminated site to a COVID patient or somebody that I think has COVID. Nowadays, somebody has symptoms or it's presumable infectious, we do a PCR, a molecular test, to know if the person indeed has a coronavirus and is a COVID patient. The same thing happens with a contaminated site. I need to go there and make a decision, a diagnostic. So I take a sample, it can be water, it can be sediment, and I take it to the lab and I use my molecular biology techniques magic, extract DNA, run a quantitative PCR. And nowadays, the general public knows what PCR is most of these days because now it's on our daily lives because of the pandemic. But yeah, I look at the genes that these bacteria have with molecular biology techniques to know if they are there. And if I have a positive result, I can say, okay, let's just stimulate the bacteria that are naturally there. And if not, let's put them at the site and eventually monitor them. So what we would do is we go there every so on, take samples for molecular biology analysis. And what I would like to see is my compound levels going up. This is with chemical analytical instruments that I can see the compound going down. While I see my bacteria going up, the levels of bacteria, and I'm counting the genes of the bacteria that can do this process, and the benign product also going up. So there's no way that I am able to take a sample and look it under the microscope and know if the bacteria that can transport the contaminant is there. No, I take a sample to extract DNA and with molecular biology tools, make a diagnostic. Again, in comparison to what I do with a COVID patient. En un lugar que está contaminado, yo tengo que decidir qué hacer. Y lo que hago son pruebas de biología molecular para saber si voy a hacer bioestimulación o bioaugmentación y tengo que diagnosticarlo como un paciente de COVID para saber si está o no la bacteria que yo quiero allí. And then I make a decision, right, about which treatment I am going to use. In the past, I have focused on a compound called 1,2-dichloropropane that was found in pesticides, and until 1970s, it was not regulated. So there are sites in the United States and the world that are contaminated with it. It's a potential carcinogen, so it's of concern. The good thing is that we have the cultures in the laboratory that can transform this compound to non-toxic propane. So even though we had the cultures in the lab that could do this, we have no idea of the genes and the molecular machinery behind this transformation. And it was my job to assign function to the gene involved in this transformation. And once I have it, I can design an assay, a qPCR approach, so that we can track it and monitor contaminated sites and in environmental samples. Mi meta era asignarle función a un gen de un contaminante que se llama 1,2-dicloropropano, porque ese gen catalizaba la reacción para que ese compuesto pasara a ser propeno, que ya no es tóxico. And I'm just going to go over this very quickly, but we have to remember the central dogma of DNA to make sense of the experiments that I conducted. A central dogma says that everything that we are and that we can do as living organisms is encoded in our DNA, that depending on stimuli or the conditions, those genes become activated, they upregulate, they make little messages for proteins that can catalyze reactions. El dogma central de la biología molecular está detrás de esto. Toda nuestra información está en el DNA. Y luego esos mensajes se convierten en RNA para luego tener proteínas que pueden llevar a cabo estas reacciones. So with having this in mind, I wanted to assign function to the gene involved in that transformation of that contaminant. So I did certain experiments to attack each of those questions with the central dogma behind it. I did transcription experiments to know which gene, which RNA messages were being made, and then enzymatic assays to later confirm that the gene indeed encoded the protein that was involved in this process. Yo hice experimentos de transcripción y experimentos enzimáticos para poderle asignar función a este gen y luego poder crear las herramientas para detectarlo. And I won't go into very much detail, but basically for the transcription experiments, I grew the cultures. They were actively growing on the contaminant, producing the non-toxic product. And I harvested the cell and I extracted RNA, same process that you do for other type of cells. It's more or less a universal DNA extraction. And I cloned it and I found a certain type of gene sequence that all my clones had in my library. It was a cDNA library for those molecular biologists aficionados out there. The cDNA library had one type of insert. When I looked at it on the databases, I saw that it was very different from what was there, and which turned out to be much more interesting. Once we had the gene sequence, we wanted to know if the protein encoded in it did had the activity. So again, we grew the cells, big volume, and separated those proteins of the active cells. And this is a blue native page image. Basically what you see is the protein being separated. They are in these bands. They are in their native form, so they're still with activity. Toda una separación de proteína donde ya todavía tienen su actividad. And I proceeded to cut sections of this gel to see which section had the activity that I was looking for, which is the transformation of the contaminant. And I saw that section number 4, this one down here, when I I extracted the proteins from this section, and when I challenged it in vitro, I saw the activity being occurring. So the contaminant was being transformed to protein. So I knew the protein that I was looking for was in this section. And later on, with more fancy techniques and collaborators, we use separation and with LC-MS proteomics approaches to really confirm that indeed the in this section, the gene, the protein that was being carrying out the transformation was the one of the gene that I had cloned. We named the gene and the protein DCPA because it's 1,2-dichloropropane, the contaminant that it was transforming. So it's a dichloropropane reductive dehalogenesis. That's the name of that protein. Later on, I went all over the world. Well, I actually got samples from all over the world. And I won't, this is a lot of information that you don't need to know, but I just want you to see that every time that I detected the gene, I could see the transformation in my cultures that had sediment from these various sites, sites in Knoxville, Tennessee, in Germany, in Florida, even in Europe sometimes. So it was a very good correlation. I see the gene, I see the transformation. So it was a multiple lines of evidence approach to assign function to this gene. And this is the summary of that work. When I began, we had no idea how this transformation occurred. Later on, we had a sequence that was a candidate gene that I got from that cDNA library. We did proteomics to confirm that the it was indeed encoded for the protein that could do the work. And I designed the quantitative PCR and other approaches to quantify the genes, not only in the samples from the lab, but also in the samples from the field. En este experimento, ¿verdad? Yo le asigné función al uno, al gen que está ligado a la transformación de 1,2-dichloropropano a propeno. Tuvimos la secuencia genómica. Luego de eso pude diseñar los ensayos para detectarlo en muestras ambientales y también en las de laboratorio. So the contribution here now that I have the sequence and we are sure that it's the gene that is carrying out this transformation. So now I have a biomarker. Now practitioners, engineers, people that want to restore a contaminated site can use this tool. And, you know, ask the first question, which is the bacteria, if a site is contaminated with 1,2-dichloropropane, you would ask, is the bacteria that can carry out the transformation there? Yes or no? No problem. Just give me 1 gram of soil or 1 liter of water. I'll extract DNA and I will apply my quantitative PCR tools. And I can tell you if the bacteria are there or not. To either we do biostimulation or we do bioaugmentation with the goal of always restoring the contaminated site. This work was part of my dissertation and various publications came out of it that I'm happy to share. It needed the bacteria that harbors and can do the transformation is from a very interesting group called the Halococoides. They're obligated anaerobes, hard to grow, but very good for this type of applications. Lastly, I wanted to share with you a little bit of what I do regarding extreme environments, which are places with high temperature, the deep ocean, close to toxic chemicals like radionuclide waste and things like that. And why do we care about extreme environments? Well, we think that by studying microbes, in these harsh conditions, we can have an idea of maybe life elsewhere. For example, there are microorganisms that thrive at Yellowstone hot springs, super high temperatures, maybe acidic conditions, where you would think nothing else could live. Well, there's microorganisms that thrive there in glaciers, for example, in the depth of the ocean where there's no light, in the Atacama Desert, which reassembles a Martian a topography. They're all living there and they're happy doing it. So we may think microorganisms that are able to do that can do that in Europa, for example, the moon that is Jupiter's moon. Ambientes extremos nos dejan saber si hay vida tal vez en el universo y en otros planetas. And not only that, we can also think about maybe they will tell us clues about how was life at the beginning of the Earth, that primitive Earth, when we were just, everything was just starting. So I've been lucky to be able to do field work on this subject at places where there are extreme environments, as this is in the islands of Azores, in Portugal. I've gotten the opportunity to sample sediment and water close to these thermal places. Azores is a volcanic island, and you see all these formities over there. Here on the map, you can see I went from one island, Puerto Rico, to another island in the Atlantic to be part of this group. I would like to say that this was a great initiative that got interdisciplinary scientists together from also many different cultures and places. So science is all about collaboration and diversity. And I'm always very honored to be putting the voice of a Latina, of a woman in the table, in sometimes in places where we are a minority. Here the group was very diverse and was very mixed. So that was very nice. One of the last few places I went, this was in Aspo, Sweden, another island, but this time way up north, where we had the opportunity to sample a tunnel and go up to a depth of 450 meters below the subsea floor. Esto fue un viaje que tuvimos donde fuimos a Suiza, a una isla, a Suecia, perdón, donde pudimos muestrear en un túnel y llegar a una profundidad de 450 metros. So we went there, why? Because we wanted to sample. Oh yeah, and to give you a perspective, the Eiffel Tower is 300 meters, so we reached a depth longer, I mean, higher than that. La Torre Eiffel solamente tiene 300 metros, nosotros fuimos más allá. And this is the type of biofilms we had the opportunity to sample. You see all these very interesting formations. They have that color because this is bacteria that can oxidize iron, so they produce that color, and very unique scenarios that I had the opportunity to see. I also had the opportunity to sample the depth of the seafloor with collaborators from Woods Hole Oceanography Institutions. And what I like to say to my students and those that may pursue a career in microbiology or in science is that, at least in my type of work, you can do both things. You can get the joys of going out to the field and sample, but also come back to the lab to answer all those questions about the diversity there. And you would say, okay, so you went to those places, you took samples, and then what did you do? Well, I used molecular biology tools, and in this case, because I wanted to know what was in the sample, the biodiversity that was harbored there. Yo uso técnicas de biología molecular para saber qué tipo de microorganismos están allí y saber sobre su filogenia. And the reason why I need to use the molecular biology tools to know more about the diversity is that 99% of bacteria, about the biodiversity of microorganisms that exist out there, don't grow on plates. They are unculturable. So it is estimated that we know less than 1% of the diversity of microbes that exist out there. And that is just amazing. We think we know a lot. No, but really, we really don't, because microorganisms are hard to culture in the lab. Most of them don't like to be in the outer plate or in a LB media very happy. No, they want harsh conditions that or need have very specific requirements that we cannot replicate in the lab. And that is the reason why some people say 99.9% of microbes are unculturable and we don't know about them. We still haven't studied them. El 99.9% de los microorganismos que existen no lo podemos crecer en plato, desconocemos de su diversidad. y es una es un reto que tenemos para ver estudiar y todo su conjunto de actividad metabólica y qué hacen. We know very little about them. And that is what we aim to do. People like me, we are on a quest to discover an untapped huge diversity of microbes that can have a lot of applications. I talked to you a little bit about bioremediation because it's work that I've done, I think for the last maybe 15 years, because I started as an undergraduate working with bioremediation. I talked to you a little bit about the application of studying microbes in extreme environments, which has a link to astrobiology and things like that. But there are even more applications regarding on the medical field, on the agricultural applications, and industrial applications as well. So it's a big field, and the only and the best way to study them is by using all these molecular biology techniques that we have been very lucky to live in this era where we have access to all these gamma of sequencing technologies of quantitative PCR. People can do it nowadays in a chip and with one sample ask thousands of genes if they're present there or not. Things like that. Vivimos en unos tiempos bien interesantes donde ahora podemos secuenciar muestras a una gran rapidez, a un bajo costo. Tenemos también una sensitividad de que podemos detectar genes con quantitative PCR, miles en una sola muestra. Sabe que estamos viviendo tiempos bien interesantes para la ciencia y para la microbiología, gracias a todas las técnicas moleculares. So this is the end of my talk and I'll be happy to answer questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Padilla. We really appreciate how you explained the science in such a way that, you know, someone unfamiliar with this research could understand. And we also appreciate that you were able to, you know, make this talk way more inclusive by translating in Spanish. So thank you so much. We have one question from our YouTube chat. So does your understanding about extremophiles give clues about the origins of life?
Yes, definitely. Like I mentioned, we think that by looking at this, the lifestyle of this extremophile, we have a glimpse of what the life, the beginning of the primitive Earth was. And we know by the fossil record, which the first fossil record that we have is stromatolites, which are signatures from bacteria from almost 3.5 billion years ago, that indeed the first form of living that we have a record are microbes, in this case, cyanobacteria, which are the responsible generators of oxygen in our atmosphere.
Right, yeah, that's really interesting. And we also have another question. So someone acknowledge that this is very interesting and inspiring work. And they ask if you have started any directed evolution to increase RDase activity.
No, I haven't, but I know there are collaborators and other groups looking into this. These reductive dehalogenase genes are very particular and they kind of, and this type of organisms that can do this reaction, the halococoides, they form a very deep branch and distinctive cluster in the tree of life. With reductive dehalogenases, we have a lot of questions. As far as we know, this bacteria can only live by these type of processes, the reductive dehalogenation, taking energy from these compounds that have a halogen atom. In this case, I explained about chlorine. But sometimes we can find them in places where there is no known source of halogenetic compounds. So it's intriguing how that has evolved.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's all our questions for now. We have a couple comments that people added in Spanish, so you can take a look at those after and Yeah, we're really thankful to have you, and we hope to continue this collaboration of having you share your research with the Genomics Institute at UCSC.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure.
Bye.
So much, Elizabeth. We really appreciate it. I'll be in touch.
So for everyone watching, we are running a little bit ahead of schedule. So we're going to take another 5-minute break, and then we'll show you our amazing strawberry DNA extraction tutorial and wrap up the event. So see you soon.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. My name is Kelly Sauter, and I work for the Genomics Institute. I wanted to let everyone know that this afternoon we will have a research panel later on from 2:30 to 4 with some great faculty members of UCSC. We will go ahead and put the link to that panel in the YouTube channel for you to watch. Thank you.
Hey everyone. So this next video is from the Treehouse Childhood Cancer Initiative led by Dr. Elena Vasky. We do phenomenal research on pediatric cancer, and this video is a segment from an event we hosted for childhood cancer patients. Enjoy.
Hi kids, my name is Snehan. I am a scientist. Today, I'm going to teach you how to extract DNA from a strawberry. First, let's make sure we have all our materials. We need cold isopropyl alcohol, so let me take that out of my fridge. We also need a Ziploc bag, a big tube or a jar or glass, then a smaller tube to store our DNA, and then a wooden stick or fork, a cheesecloth or strainer or a coffee filter to filter out big pieces of strawberry, a mixing bowl, 3 strawberries, and then some water, dishwashing liquid, and salt. Do you have all your materials ready?
Hi, I'm Grant. And I'm Aurora. We have all the spice, alcohol, salt, water, dish soap, and strawberries.
Great, let's measure out all our ingredients. We need a 1/3 cup of water, one tablespoon of dishwashing liquid, and 1/2 teaspoon of salt. Now we can mix it all together.
We're ready to make our extraction solution.
Okay, now that we have our extraction solution, let's work on our strawberries. So first we can de-stem the strawberries. And put them in our Ziploc bag. Make sure to tightly close the bag. And you can start mushing.
So we want to try to make sure that there aren't too many big chunks of strawberries, okay? So try and mush all the big chunks as best as you can. So now we can add the extraction liquid into the bag. You might need a parent's or sibling's help with this one. So open the bag and add your extraction liquid. Tightly close the bag
make sure that everything mixes up together so you get some bubbles. Now it's time to add our strawberry solution into our test tube or cup. So you can have a parent or sibling help you with this step. Someone can hold the test tube with the strainer on top of it, and another person can pour the liquid into the tube. Make sure to pour slowly. This step also requires a sibling or parent or friend to help. So we're going to pour our cold alcohol into the test tube, but make sure to pour it at an angle. And pour it along the side of the test tube so it doesn't mix with the strawberry solution. We only need about the same amount of strawberry solution for the alcohol. And here we are.
We're ready to pour in the alcohol.
Our very last step is to extract the DNA from the solution. So, in between the alcohol and strawberry layers, you'll see a lot of cloudy viscous material, and that's our DNA. So take a stick or a toothpick or a fork, and we're gonna swirl around the liquid to get the DNA. See how it swirls? Okay. Now I'm gonna set that down and put my DNA, into my small tube. And our DNA is sort of collecting at the bottom of the tube. You can always go back into the solution to get a little bit more DNA that you might have left behind. Close your tube. And there you have it. Inside this tube is strawberry DNA.
Now we're going to try to scoop out our DNA. There's a hot.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Gavin. Please put the last of it in here.
The droppings on it too. Mm-hmm. I didn't get that much.
All right, you got some. Right there.
So today we learned how to extract DNA from a strawberry. If you want to learn the science behind this experiment, please feel free to look at the handout we gave you. Thank you. Bye.
Hey everyone, I hope you all can try out our DNA extraction at home. So our very last segment today is from my Colleges Against Cancer committee. I'd also like to give a shout out to our tech chair, Dylan Harutunian, who is working behind the scenes to keep this live stream up. So thank you, Dylan. And our link to the link to our website will be posted in the YouTube chat after the event, so please check it out. Hi, I'm Sneha, and I'm one of the co-leads of Colleges Against Cancer at UC Santa Cruz. I'm here with the rest of the committee, and we took part in planning and hosting today's DNA Day event. Our club hosts events related to cancer awareness and we fundraise for nonprofits that support cancer patients. This year, we hosted an event for Latinas Contra Cancer, a nonprofit in San Jose that supports cancer patients from the Latinx population. In previous years, we've hosted blood drives, community building events, and small fundraisers.
Hi, I'm Isha, and I'm the other co-lead of Colleges Against Cancer. Due to the pandemic, we have only hosted virtual events this year. Our biggest event is Relay for Life, which is traditionally a 12-hour fundraiser hosted at Oprah's Field to raise awareness and encourage the college population to get involved in cancer activism. This year, our Relay for Life will be held on Saturday, May 22nd from 1 to 5 p.m. We'll have videos and activities from other organizations on campus, as well as researchers, cancer survivors, and cancer caregivers that will share their stories. We encourage you all to follow our Instagram at CACUCSC for more updates about our event. We also have a Colleges Against Cancer website that will continually be updated. You can register for Relay for Life on this website. Thank you all for watching DNA Day, and we hope you all stay healthy and safe. Now we'd like our committee members to introduce themselves. They'll share their names, pronouns, and one word that describes their reason for being in Colleges Against Cancer.
Hi, my name's Sneha, my pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is activism.
Hi, my name is Isha, and my pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is vulnerability.
Hi, my name is Dylan, and my pronouns are he, him, his. My word is support.
Hi, my name is Areli, my pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is compassion.
Hi, my name is Raina, my pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is hope.
Hi, my name is Jimmy, my pronouns are he, him, his, and my word is love.
Hi, my name is Nico, my pronouns are he, him, his, and my word is awareness.
Hi, my name is Katie, my pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is perseverance.
Hi, my name is Darshini, my pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is compassion.
Hi, my name is Malvi. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is solidarity.
Hi, my name is Sapna, and my pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is friendship.
Hi, my name is Yvonne. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is community.
Hi, my name is Keki. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is empathy.
Hi, my name is Shruti. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is strength.
Hi, my name is Erin. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is family.
Hi, my name is Shivani. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is outreach.
Hi, my name is Vega. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and my word is kindness.
Thank you all so much for attending DNA Day. Please reach out to us via Instagram for more information about our club. Thank you.
Hey, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us for DNA Day 2021. Thanks again to the Colleges Against Cancer for helping us mount this event online. Remember that this is recorded so you can come back and watch again and again, and we hope you do. Some of the scientific talks are definitely worth hearing a second time. If you want to follow our speakers, you can look them up on the Genomics Institute website. And please join us next year. We'll be back live and in person in the Baskin Engineering Courtyard. We'll have a poster session, a research fair, which will include a table of the Treehouse Childhood Cancer Project and Colleges Against Cancer. And we will have a live strawberry DNA extraction. So look for us next year. It'll be right around April 25th every year, National DNA Day. Thank you for joining us.